I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end, he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I want to welcome you to this celebration of life for my Uncle Paul. Those words from Job, I know that he believed those. It's an honor to be here as we remember him and reflect on his life. Thank you for coming.
Please bow your heads. Our Father in heaven, we come before you here today with heavy hearts, but also with gratitude for the life of our friend, family member, mentor, teacher, Paul. We celebrate the memories we have shared with him and the impact he has made on our lives. Today, we gather to honor his life and to celebrate the love, joy, and hope that he brought into our lives. We thank you for creating him and for the journey he had. We ask that you help us remember the good times we shared with him, to cherish the moments we had with him, and to honor the legacy by continuing to live our lives with kindness and compassion. We pray for comfort and strength for his family and friends during this difficult time. May you put your healing hand on their hearts and provide them with peace and comfort as they grieve. We ask that you bless Paul's soul and grant him eternal peace in your loving arms. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
My grandpa's favorite verse is Romans 8:28, and it says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose."
Let's join together in some songs of worship. If you want to take out your hymnal, the first one, "Because He Lives," is on page 526.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to Sweet hour of prayer, sweet in seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, the wings shall my petition bear to him whose faithfulness engage the waiting soul to bless. And since he bids me seek his face, believe his word and trust his grace, I'll cast on him my every care and wait for thee, sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, may I thy consolation share, till from Mount Pisgah's lofty height I view my flight. In my immortal flesh I'll rise to seize the everlasting prize, and shout while passing through the air, farewell, farewell, sweet hour of.
And page 457, I love to tell the story. We'll do two verses.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. Will be my theme in glory, to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancy of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story, it did so much for me, and that is just the reason I tell it now to thee. I love to tell the story, will be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.
take a breather here. My dad was a bad, we'll leave it at that. So, yeah. Welcome. Thank you for coming and supporting the Willis family. If you haven't met me, I'm James, Paul's middle child. I grew up in this church. It's been probably 30 years since I was up on this platform. I was married here to my first wife. Anyways, so brings back lots of memories here. My dad loved this church so much. As a member for 30 plus years, Dad always looked forward to going to church and teaching the Sabbath school lesson. He would always tell me on Sunday if he didn't make it to church for some reason, he would be really bummed out that, you know, his ride, you know, couldn't make it because of the weather or something. But Dad's life begins just recently. We went up to my cabin in Cascade for the first time. Thanksgiving, that is all Dad could talk about for months leading up to that. Well, it rolled around. Off we went on snowy roads up to Cascade, and possibly there was a close encounter with a ditch or something, maybe, on the way up there. But anyways, not to give you a heart attack, Dad, no pun intended, but next was getting Dad food. Dad was very picky at what he would eat, and he had his set diet, and so getting him what he would eat for Thanksgiving was always a challenge, or in general what he would eat, and Suzanne would always have to go shopping for him. And if he didn't get his food by a certain time, he would call. He would call me, or he would call Paul, and was like, hey, where's Suzanne? You know, can you give her a reminder that I need, you know, need my prune juice, or I need my pineapple, or whatever. So, anyways, when we got into Cascade, we went to the grocery store, and you know, you all been in small towns where, you know, there's not a big selection. Well, finding, you know, Dad his veggie turkey loaf for Thanksgiving didn't end up coming too, so we had to improvise and find him something else that he would eat. But it was great memories up there. He was always looking forward to, you know, seeing our cabin and seeing what us kids had accomplished in life. And anyway, unfortunately, Paul and his family couldn't make it because of the bad roads. But back to Dad's dedication, as Saturday rolled around, Dad was always dedicated, like I said, to come into this church. And he kept on bringing up that he wanted us to drive him on Saturday back to church here, and then after church turn around and head back up to the cabin. Take it on snowy roads after, you know, I about gave him a heart attack earlier. But we finally convinced Dad that, hey, you know, God would be okay with you skipping one weekend. So on to the next stories about Dad. Dad loved the outdoors. That's how the kids, we always grew up camping and fishing and hiking. Dad rode motorcycles as kids, and anyways, I always wanted a motorcycle, and he would never let me have one because, you know, he had wrecked probably, I don't know how many times, but anyways, I was never able to have one until I was in high school and able to buy my own. So the last few years, Dad wasn't very mobile, but I would always take the time in the summer to take him fishing. Dad, that was his big thing, like talking about going to the cabin. He would, you know, he would talk for months because I would call him every Sunday. I was dedicated to talk to him, even if I had to, you know, put something off to call him, because, you know, if I didn't call him at 2:30 or 3 o'clock when I got off work, I would be getting a call. So, and if, you know, if 4:30 rolled around, he'd be calling the rest of us siblings, hey, you know, where's James? So, anyways, Dad wasn't very mobile for the last few years because of his heart, but I would always take him down to Marcine, to the fishing pond there. Rob and Jackson, their family, and my friend Jeff, and a few others would join us, and we would have a fishing outing with Dad. And Dad would always catch the big ones. And anyways, he would always, you know, want to get a bigger one, you know. And this last time I took him this last summer, it was a full moon the night before, and we tried to fish and never caught a big one. But unfortunately, just had to give up. But he, you know, he would always talk about the same story. You know, I'm sure the rest of us will be doing that when we get to that age. But anyways. I think my dad's most favorite thing to do was rock hounding. My Uncle Don and him, I remember numerous times them taking us out into the Waihees in a car, two-wheel drive. You know, it just rained the night before, and here we're going down these roads and big mud puddles, and when we'd get stuck, and they'd figure out a way to get out. And anyways, this last car that I got Dad, I believe Donna, his wife, and him were dating at the time. Can you correct me, Donna, or were you married? Anyways, he took Donna out there on a date, I believe, in this brand new maroon Buick that I had found for him. And it didn't even have a scratch on it. It was elderly couples. This thing was immaculate, beautiful. And we're like, Dad, if you put a scratch on this car, we're going to take it away from you. Well, he somehow, it had a backup alarm and camera. Anyways, he managed to back into a big boulder out there for the first time. Anyways, Dad had lots of encounters with death, to say the least, as probably many of you heard, because Dad loved telling stories. So from a trip to Wyoming to see his Uncle Sammy, he fell asleep and went off the road and rolled the car numerous times, and he walked away, to going out to the Napa dump where he always drove like a bat out of something. Anyways, I don't know what the big rush was to get to the Napa dump, but anyways, he was driving Paul's truck and lawn darted this truck into a ditch bank, and we don't know how he survived that, but walked away with a few broken ribs at the time. But oh. Yeah, so after all those episodes, we were thankful when he got in a little fender bender in the parking lot and they were able to take his car away and we didn't have to explain to him that, that, hey, Dad, it's, time, to give it up. I'm so grateful for the extra 2 years. That we got with you, Dad, after spending 3 nights in the ICU with him, when they were able to bring him back and give him a pacemaker, us family knew that, his time was short and we would be blessed with whatever time he was given. After he survived that, him and Donna both got COVID, and they survived that for a few months. And we were shocked because, his heart was so weak. But I always say that we all have our time, and doesn't matter what you're doing or where you're at, your clock runs out, it's out. I'm thankful on February 2nd, when Dad passed away, that was the last time I got to see him. Suzanne had asked if I would step in, because I was going to be in town, to take him to a VA appointment to see if he could have a minor surgery. Anyways, they ran an EKG that day. Thank you, Pastor. And maybe the machine was BS, but I mean, I was there watching it, and his heart came back perfect. The doctor, because a few months earlier Suzanne had taken him, and it looked great, and they're like, wow. Your percentage of, having some kind of problem in the surgery is very minimal. And so, the three of us had talked, and we were all against him having the surgery just because, we felt that it was a risk. But 10 hours later, the angels took him. As I was driving him back home, Dad sang "Jesus Loves Me" to me. And I didn't really think of it at the time. We had a good conversation for the hour drive back from Boise. And I told him, that I would see him on Monday because he wanted a haircut. And I said, well, Dad, I'll be back down from Cascade and I'll take you to get a haircut. That night, Suzanne called and said that she had taken him into the hospital a few hours later, and he was having some complications. Anyways, but they said, hey, we got him cleared up. He's looking good. We're just gonna keep him, overnight for observation. Well, she called later and said that things really went wrong. And, Dad didn't make it. And it wasn't till then that I knew that the heavenly angels were singing with him. after, you know, after thinking about it, it just, you know, it just wasn't his voice. It just sounded so much more beautiful and, you know, lifting. So, anyways, I know the angels were calling him to heaven. This is the last story I'm going to tell about Dad. Our dad had a heavenly blessing. He might not have ever shared it much with you guys, but my dad walked closer than anybody I know with God. He read his Bible and did his lesson every day. Family was everything to my parents, and family vacations were always built around going to visit my Uncle Jimmy, my Aunt Gloria, and all the family in California. This was a special trip for us. As we go down memory lane, my parents were always missionaries. They always gave to the church and to the service of spreading God's word. Well, this time, my mom had worked hard to take us kids to Disneyland. Suzanne was pretty small at this time. And anyways, we were enjoying this day at Disneyland. And as kids do, you know, we never wanted to stop. We were always full of energy. And my dad would have these spiritual, I would call them convictions, or I don't know, God talked to him. Anyways, he had this spiritual feeling that day that we were at Disneyland. And this was before cell phones and stuff, and so there was no way to, you know that something was going on. Well, our loving Aunt Gloria that day had a medical issue, and my dad had this conviction. God had given him this conviction that something was going on, and so, you know, us kids, you know, we're like, hey, you know, we got to go. And so anyways, we ended up leaving, and it was true. Something did happen, but we were there and able to help support my Uncle Jimmy and their family. And then a few weeks after that, my Uncle Jimmy worked right near the hospital there, and my Aunt Gloria was in the hospital there, and my dad had envisioned seeing her walk over to meet my Uncle Jimmy, and sure enough, you know, God had, you know, given him that blessing. So I know if anyone makes it to heaven, Dad will. I always had that in the back of my mind when I was up to mischief, that Dad could see what I was up to. But I never had the chance to ask him, but it always sat in the back of my mind. One of my last stories before I close, on a serious but funny note, Dad always had a strong belief, and he would preach or share his belief, and he would always share his religious belief, but he always believed that there was healing in herbs. And as Dad's memory was slipping, I know he took great pride in memorizing his sales pitch. And it started out like this, and I'm sure many of you have heard this, and it's okay. It is my belief that turmeric kills cancer, And if you don't believe me, he would always say, go to lifeextensions.com. And that day, Dad also gave me Life Extensions magazine and said, hey, will you please look at this and see if that'll work out for me? So, and he always would share magazines of all those kinds of things. And Suzanne still receives them in the mail, and I'm sure she totally appreciates that. So, and I'm sure if there was one in there that would have fixed his heart, he would have lived to 100. And he would always end his sales pitch, and I don't know how this correlated, but he would say, our Aunt Donnie had a Toyota car, and she ran MagnaTech oil, and if you run MagnaTech oil, you'll get 300,000 miles out of your car. So, I don't know what the correlation was, but he sure had something figured out there. Dad, as yours and Mom's spirit watches over us, I want to thank you and Mom for all that you've done for us kids, raised in us to lead by your great example, and I promise, Mom, I will see you that glorious day. And you better have your cowboy boots on. I love you, Mom, Dad.
Thank you. your side, I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only
I'm Paul's sister. It was Paul, my mom, Pam, then my Uncle Sonny, and then Priscilla, and I'm Pam's daughter. I told myself I wasn't going to cry, so it's not going too well, though. It's hard seeing pictures of my parents because my dad died in 2010, my mom in 2014, and I'm here because I know they would want me to be here. A few funny memories I have of my Uncle Paul. One is, at one point, I went to visit him when I was younger, And I remember James had like this big muscle car. I'm not sure what it was, a Mustang or something. I remember that. And I also remember my Aunt Susie was still around, and they always were like the healthy part of the family. Like, we all knew that they were the healthy ones, and they ate healthy. And they had made this breakfast, and they were so excited. We're going to have pancakes. I'm like, yeah, pancakes. And then I started eating them. I'm like, what is this? Oh, it's buckwheat pancakes. I'm like, oh, like, I've remembered that my whole life. And I remember going, like, chewing it, going, yeah, okay, this is good. And I couldn't be rude, you know, but I remember thinking, oh, my gosh, these are the weirdest pancakes I've ever eaten in my life. Totally different than what I grew up with. After my parents passed, my Uncle Paul would call for me and my daughters and even my husband's birthdays, even though it may not have been the right date, but he always called. And I have all these messages from him. It was just really sweet. It was like once my parents were gone, he wanted to step in and do those things for us. I chose the song, Praise You in the Storm, because what I experienced from my Uncle Paul, and although we always lived far from them, I remember seeing the cousins, James and Paul and Suzanne, when I was younger. What I remember about my Uncle Paul is when Aunt Susie died, he was so, like, he was still praising God in the storm, you know? He was still, you know, God is still good no matter what happens in your life, because he knew the end game. He knew what the end game was going to be. So why be sorrowful? Why be sad if we know what the end game is? And so I always, at a young age, my Aunt Susie dying of cancer and me feeling very bad for my cousins for losing her young, and then my parents dying of cancer. I did get that talk. He called me up about the turmeric, about my mom when she had brain cancer. He gave me the whole turmeric talk. So it's kind of funny. Anyways, so I chose this song because it reminds me so much of him and how he lived his life.
Sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. As the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I raise my hands, praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, 'cause you are who you are, no matter where. Every tear I've cried, you hold in your hands. You never left my side. And though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm. I remember when I stumbled in the wind. You heard my cry, you raised me up again. My strength is almost gone. How can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in the storm, and I will lift my hands, 'cause you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you. I will praise you in this storm. Oh. I will praise you in this storm.
Amen. Lots of good music this afternoon. I think, Nicolette, I like your version better than Casting Crowns. I think we need to call them and have you go on one of their tours. Enjoyed all the music. Thank you, ladies and the young gentlemen that played for them. I'll tell you, I've learned more about Paul in just the last hour than I've known before about him. And I was sitting there thinking, so I was sitting in the front row here, like, why do we do this? Why do we wait to the final moments? Why do we wait till they're gone? I mean, wouldn't it be fun now to be able to end the service and go over to the fellowship hall and have that reception over there and talk to Paul about what he was thinking at certain times, certain moments when he was doing certain things? I would have never, before today, pictured Paul being a cyclist. Never. Was not even on the radar. Another thing that wasn't on the radar, I did not know that Paul was a fan of KTSY. I would have never known that. We would have enjoyed some moments together if I'd known that to be the case. I did know about the turmeric. I often told my wife, because he'd bring it up more than once, and I said, honey, I got to get in the sun. I've got to get some more color in me. Paul thinks I'm coming down with cancer because he keeps talking to me about the turmeric. I tried to explain to him over and over. I said, Paul, I take turmeric every day. I don't know. Maybe it was just my lack of color in the wintertime that he thought I looked sickly and needed to avoid the cancer. Well, I'm going to share. The family wrote a life sketch, a eulogy for Paul that I'm going to share with you. There's an abbreviated version on the back of your bulletin. But I'm going to share with you what they provided me. Paul Allen Willis Jr. was born on December 28, 1941 in Honolulu, Hawaii, as they say, I guess. His birth was just 21 days after the attack on Pearl Harbor, and bombs had been dropped within blocks of his home. Wow. I think it's amazing that his mom did not have the baby right during the bomb dropping with all that tension and all the things that were going on there. His dad, Paul Sr., was stationed at the naval base during that time and was the personal secretary for Admiral Kimmel and later Admiral Nimitz. Life was very stressful at that time, and as many Navy families were scrambling to get back home to the mainland, Paul and his wife, Ardella, decided to stay and continue to serve their country. This began Dad's love of history and why he always called himself a Pearl Harbor survivor. Dad would finally tell us stories of living right off a pineapple plantation and going to the beaches with his mom in Oahu. This also began his love of Hawaiian things, such as eating fresh pineapple, macadamia nuts, the smell of island flowers, and visiting the ocean. When he was very young, his dad worked many long hours for the Navy, and he was raised primarily by his mom. In his baby book, Paul Sr. wrote a letter to his firstborn. It said, quote, "You were brought into the world during a time that demanded the utmost courage and sacrifice," end quote. It was a time in our history where people had to have determination and strength to survive. It was this tenacity that Paul saw modeled by his dad and mom that would later help him get through his toughest times in life. When Paul was 5 years old, his dad returned the family to San Diego, California, where he attended school and grew up. Paul became the oldest of four children. He had two sisters and one brother. School was not easy for him, and he faced many challenges. He would also tell us about the wildlife the wild life that he lived of riding motorcycles and getting into fights. Didn't see that one coming. This was so hard for us children to believe. I can understand that. Right after high school at age 17, he got his dad to sign him up to join the Navy. He served for a few years during peaceful times. One of his final jobs was working as an instructor for the Fleet Anti-Air Warfare Training Center in San Diego. He would often talk about training pilots and how much fun he had teaching. It was also about this time in his life that he became an Adventist, and his life changed forever. He met a man named Don Hill, who led him to Jesus and later introduced him to his family. One Friday evening, Don took him home where his wife, Donna, and his sister-in-law, Alda, always known as Susie to her family, had been playing their instruments in their PJs. When they found out that Don had brought home a guest, they quickly ran to get their house coats on. That's you know, old school for their bathrobe. Yes, thank you. Thank you. See, that's a little before my time. This impromptu visit was actually the beginning of our parents' love story. Paul was still in the Navy at the time, and Susie was attending La Sierra College. They would correspond by mail and see each other as much as possible. In the summer of 1962, Paul left the Navy and moved to La Sierra to start attending school with her. They spent as much time together as they could and were married by June of 1963. During their honeymoon years, they loved to travel and would spend hours camping, collecting shells at the ocean, and rock hounding in the desert. The highlight of their honeymoon years was their trip around the United States in 1966. They took in the beautiful sights and collected items for teaching everywhere they went. In 1968, they started their family with the birth of their son, Paul. Then in 1969, they moved to Pacific Union College so he could finish his teaching degree, and shortly after that, James was born in 1970. Then 10 years later, they added a baby girl to the family with the birth of Suzanne. In Dad's words, Susie helped me in every endeavor I attempted and helped me to be successful. Mom and Dad were lucky to share almost 40 years of happy marriage together. By 1970, Dad had completed his teaching degree with minors in history and religion. This opened the doors for them to live in several different states and see more of the U.S. One memorable place we lived was at La Vida Indian Mission School in New Mexico. This gave us kids a chance to learn about Native American culture and taught us how to help others and live a life of service. Dad and Mom taught there for just a couple of years before settling in Idaho for the last 40 years. Over the years, Dad had various jobs as a teacher, principal, hospital administrator. Did not know that. Owning their own elderly care homes, and later in life as a substitute teacher. He was proud of still being able to substitute teach well into his 70s. Teaching and subbing brought him so much joy. He would often proudly tell people how he had volunteered and also subbed in his daughter's classroom as well as his grandson's classrooms. He subbed in hundreds of classrooms across Canyon County until his health started to decline. After he couldn't teach anymore, he would always ask Suzanne about school, how many kids she had, and how things were going. He just missed being around the kids. Family, faith, and a life of service were their life. Both of our parents were very loving and supportive parents. They loved us all equally and took the time to share special interests with each kid. Dad and Mom attended and helped with every program we were in. If there was a performance or school event, we knew that they would be there. As we went away to college, Mom and Dad would call us every Sunday to check in on us, even after we lost Mom in 2003 to cancer, I believe. Dad would continue this tradition of making sure he called every Sunday. Dad wasn't perfect. Come on, who of us are? But the one thing us kids always knew was how much he loved us and worried about us. He would end every call with, "I love you," and "I'm praying for you." Even if he had to leave a voicemail, he would tell us all the things he was praying for in regards to us and our children. He was a man of deep faith, and he loved Jesus. He would often talk about faith, prayer, and listening to the Holy Spirit. Dad would also tell people that he could count at least 15 times that God had saved his life. They were working overtime, I guess, those angels, huh? After he lost Mom, he had a really hard time and church became his everything. I can attest to that. Every possible Sabbath he could be here, Paul was here, and if I remember right, it was right there in the back on the right side, on my right side, that he would be there, and he would talk to me during the service. Right? I knew he was listening. I'd rather have people talk to me than fall asleep. After he lost mom, he had a really hard time, and church became his everything. Sorry. It was his way to stay, to still stay connected to this world. He would listen daily to KTSY, and he didn't want to miss a single Sabbath. He was bummed in his health when his health kept him away from church. He also still enjoyed teaching Sabbath school class as much as possible, and he did that almost up to his dying day. I remember we had one of the Sabbath school teachers that he taught, or he attended that class, and they weren't able to make it there that day. We put a sign up saying, you know, check out another Sabbath school class. Paul came early. He came over and he took that note down and he went and opened the door and was ready to teach class. Dad was very proud to be an American and part of the Chickasaw Indian tribe. We would regularly hear stories about how our family and their connection to the Native American tribe, how it's connected to the Native American tribe. He would probably wear his coat showing that he was a member. In 2015, our dad was invited to visit Washington, D.C. The free trip was in honor of Chickasaw veterans who had served our country. Dad was able to take James as his guest. Dad was still in good health, and they were able to make, or they were able to take in many of the monuments and the memorials. They had so much fun, and Dad especially treasured getting to see the World War II memorial. It was in these latter years that Dad decided that he still wanted to travel, he wanted to live life, and to get remarried. God blessed Dad by leading him to meet a very special lady named Donna. Her name at that time was Gonzalez, Donna Gonzalez. Donna was so loving, gentle, and caring, just like the mom we had grown up with. She was compassionate and took such good care of our dad. Dad was searching for companionship and someone to enjoy life with. He would often tell us about where they had gone, the movies that they were watching, or whatever book they were currently reading together. One of the highlights of their marriage was getting to go back to Hawaii for their honeymoon. Dad had always wanted to go back there where he was born and had not been back to Hawaii in over 70 years. They were able to visit for several days and take in the beautiful sights while they were there. They were married for such a short time. Was 5 years as of yesterday. But their marriage brought Dad great joy in the final years of his life and gave him something to live for. It's a little tidbit here. As many of you know, both Donna and Paul, the last 5 years, shortly after their marriage, had some real challenges with health and other things that here recently caused them to have to even take up residence in separate places. But every night, a phone call would be made, from what Donna told me. They would have their morning or their evening devotions and share a prayer together. That's commitment. In his retirement years, Paul took every chance he could to tell people about his children, their spouses, and his grandchildren. He would tell them about their careers, the sports or things they were doing, and just how very proud he was of them. He became more carefree with age. We noticed his sense of humor, teasing, and playfulness come out more once he had grandchildren. He loved to tell the grandchildren he would get their, quote, twinkle toes, end quote, when he would tickle them. From what I understand, you could just look at Paul And he would start giggling because he was overly ticklish himself. So then he would end up giggling just as much as they did. Dad loved to make jokes and laugh, even if it was sometimes at himself or his own stubbornness. That love of being a teacher never left either. As Suzanne would take him to all of his medical appointments, he would always end up the visit by asking to share some nugget of health advice or something he thought that would make their life better. I witnessed this because Paul and I also frequented the same barbershop. And I would run into him as I'd go in. He would be just finishing up, and sure enough, there he would be telling about turmeric or something else, and then be on his way. Dad was also a fighter to the very end. That strong determination that he started out as a baby helped him survive losing his wife, caring for and losing his parents, and almost losing his own life several times. This was especially evident when his heart stopped a couple of years ago. He survived a week in ICU and a month at St. Luke's. However, Dad wouldn't let it stop him. He pushed on, going to rehab multiple times over the years and learning to get back on his feet again. We are so grateful that we each got to spend the holidays with Dad this last year. Our dad will be missed, but we are glad that he finally has peace in his resting. He will always be remembered for how he faced life with a positive outlook, his love for Jesus and others, and his faith that all things work together for good for those that love and serve the Lord. Paul leaves behind his three children, their spouses, and six grandchildren that he loved dearly, as well as his loving wife, Donna, her daughter, and two grandchildren. So to Paul's children, grandchildren, to Donna, his present wife, I guess I'd like to wrap up this service with, once again, reminding us of a promise that Jesus gave his disciples and gives to his followers today. Do not let your hearts be troubled. We can grieve. Grieving is a part of this. But we grieve like believers. Trust in God. Jesus says, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, some say many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if Jesus is going to go to the trouble to go to a place to prepare for us, he goes on and he says, I'm going to come back. Because Jesus longs to be with us. He longs to be with us. I'll come back and I'll take you to be with me, that you will also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. How do we know the way? How do we get there? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Jesus is the way. Paul knew that. He believed it. He trusted in it. And I know one day he plans to walk into it, that new kingdom. When Jesus said this to his disciples that he was going away, they were troubled, of course. And we find in verse 16, this is John 14, verse 16, he says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor or comforter to be with you forever. So Donna, children and grandchildren, family members and friends, what we can't have now, conversations with Paul, going fishing, being terrorized by his driving, whatever it might be, right? He may not be able to be here that we can get advice from concerning cancer or something else. God has sent another comforter, his Holy Spirit, to be with us, to remind us of these words today. And lastly, I want to share from Thessalonians, another passage often heard during these times, these services, but I think it's appropriate. Brothers and sisters, this is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I'm going to read verses 13 through 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and that he rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own words, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left to the coming of the Lord, we will not certainly precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself is going to come down from heaven with a loud command and with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left, we're going to be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, Paul says, encourage each other with these words. And so we don't say goodbye today to Paul. We must say goodbye to what can't be right now. But as believers in Christ, we can say, we'll see you soon. We'll see you soon when Jesus returns. We'll be going home. And I believe it's just as that hymn says, in a little while. In a little while, we're going home. These words are faithful and true and worthy of complete acceptance, because God always keeps his promises. Before we close our service with prayer this afternoon, on behalf of the family, I want to thank all of you for coming, for those that you who participated and helped this service be memorable. Thank you. On behalf of the family, also, I would like to invite you that when we close with prayer, we're going to go ahead and dismiss the family. Allow the family members to go and be in the back. And there will be a reception, I understand, that will be in the fellowship hall, which is, I'm sorry, you're going to have to walk across the parking lot to my right, your left. And the fellowship hall will be over there. There'll be blue doors on the right-hand side that you want to go to. There'll be somebody there to guide you. But they would love to have you join them for a small reception. Again, thank you on behalf of the family for your support. Also, as you leave, if you didn't notice when you do leave, there are some tables out there with some memorabilia, some pictures. You can enjoy those as well. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for sharing this life, the life of Paul Willis, with us. Thank you for this service today and the opportunity to remember and even learn for some of us some of the things concerning Paul's life. Especially, Father, his faith and trust in you. I pray, Father, that we would take that example, and we, if we haven't already, that we would put our faith and trust in you and in you alone. Again, Father, I thank you for bringing all these people here safely, both friends and family. I pray now as we close this service that, again, God of great comfort, the Holy Spirit, please be with Paul's family. Continue to comfort them, encourage them in the days ahead, especially at those quiet moments when they can reflect on things of the past and as memories are relived in their minds. Continually remind them and take them forward to the reunion day and the resurrection, when once again we can be reunited with those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. And be with us, Lord, in our reception, and then in our journeys home. Help us to once again remember the life that you shared with us, and even more importantly, the life, Jesus, that you shared by giving your life for us, so that we can have eternal life. In the Lord Jesus' name, I pray this prayer. Amen. So again, if you can remain seated, we'll dismiss the family first, and then we'll dismiss you by rows.